Hello, Copperheads. My name is Kupri, and here we are, yet another Wednesday, learning together about Wilson's disease. We have already covered the blood and urine tests that should always be performed at the beginning of a Wilson's disease diagnostic process, which are number 1, serum choroplasmin, number 2, total serum copper, number 3, 24-hour urine copper, and number 4, if available, free serum copper. Otherwise, this value can be approximated by using math to estimate non-choroplasmin-bound serum copper. Today, I want to go through a few more blood and urine tests that are commonly included in the diagnostic process. So, as we know, the first body part Wilson's disease begins to damage is the liver, even if it's not the first place where symptoms begin to show. So let's talk about the liver function panel, which is a group of several blood tests that are performed together in order to assess how well the liver is working. The liver function panel usually measures the following values from your blood serum or plasma. Number 1, total serum protein. Number 2, serum albumin. Number 3, serum globulins, which may be split into the different types of globulin. Number 4, serum bilirubin. Number 5, prothrombin time, PT, which is used to calculate the international normalized ratio, INR. Number 6, serum alanine transaminase, ALT, also called alanine aminotransferase, ALAT. Number 7, serum aspartate transaminase, AST, also called aspartate aminotransferase, ASAT. And number 8, serum alkaline phosphatase, ALP or AP. Let's go briefly through each of them. Number 1, total serum protein, usually expressed in grams per liter. The amount of total protein in blood serum can be low due to liver damage and also kidney damage. But it can also be low for other reasons, for example, if you're taking estrogen therapy. And it's also possible to have liver damage from Wilson's disease and still have normal levels of total serum protein. Number 2, serum albumin, usually in grams per liter. Albumin is one type of protein in your blood serum, and it is made by the liver. Serum albumin can be low due to liver damage and also kidney damage, but it can also be low for other reasons, for example, if you suffer from chronic inflammation. And it's also possible to have liver damage from Wilson's disease and still have normal levels of serum albumin. Number 3, serum globulins, usually in grams per liter. Globulins are a family of proteins in your blood serum. Some of them are made by the liver and some are not. Serum globulins can be high due to liver damage, but also for other reasons, for example, if you have iron deficiency. And it's also possible to have liver damage from Wilson's disease and still have normal levels of serum globulins. Number 4, serum bilirubin, usually in micromoles per liter. Bilirubin is a normal waste product that forms all over your body when red blood cells break down. The liver takes bilirubin from the blood and moves it into bile, which then leaves the body when you poop, as we covered in Copperheads 4. Serum bilirubin can be high due to liver damage, but also for other reasons, for example, if your body is destroying red blood cells very fast due to some other condition. And it's also possible to have liver damage from Wilson's disease and still have normal levels of serum bilirubin. Number 5, prothrombin time, expressed in seconds, which is the time it takes blood plasma to clot after adding something called a tissue factor. Because the results can vary a lot depending on the method used, a lab can do some math with the prothrombin time and calculate the international normalized ratio. If your prothrombin time or international normalized ratio are higher than normal, it means that your blood coagulates too slowly, which can be due to liver damage, but also for other reasons, for example, if you're taking blood thinning medication. It's also possible to have liver damage from Wilson's disease and still have a normal prothrombin time. Finally, let's look at numbers 6, 7, and 8 together. Alanine transaminase, aspartate transaminase, and alkaline phosphatase are all enzymes made by the liver as well as other tissues and organs in your body. And these results are expressed in units per liter. As we covered in Copperheads 9, most enzyme testing methods do not give a concentration value in terms of, for example, micromoles per liter. Instead, they give an activity value in terms of, for example, enzymatic units per liter. The activity values for these three enzymes are usually very high when you have liver damage, but it is quite common for Wilson's disease patients with severe liver damage to have values within the normal range or only slightly elevated. The overall takeaway idea with the liver function panel is the following. If you have Wilson's disease, your liver function panel results might look normal because your liver is not super damaged yet. But there are cases of Wilson's disease patients who are at the emergency room literally dying from liver failure, and their liver function panel values look normal or only somewhat abnormal. So, if you have symptoms of severe liver failure, as we covered in Copperheads 5, but your liver panel does not have extremely abnormal values, do not let your doctor underestimate how serious your situation is. Alright, so now that we have covered the liver function panel, let's talk about another blood panel called Complete Blood Count, CBC. This panel usually measures number 1, red blood cells, number 2, hemoglobin, number 3, hematocrit, number 4, mean corpuscular volume, MCV, number 5, mean corpuscular hemoglobin, MCH, number 6, mean corpuscular hemoglobin concentration, MCHC, number 7, red cell distribution width, RDW, number 8, white blood cells, usually split into neutrophils, lymphocytes, monocytes, eosinophils, and basophils, and number 9, platelets. I'm not gonna go very deep into this right now because I don't wanna torture you with another 20-minute video like last week.
Oops.
And also because I do think that doctors who don't know much about Wilson's disease will be able to interpret these results correctly. So, basically, it goes like this. The first 6 values can help us see if you have hemolytic anemia, which happens when your body is destroying red blood cells too fast, which can be a sign of liver damage from Wilson's disease. The white blood cell values can help us determine if you have an autoimmune condition, for example, autoimmune hepatitis, and also if you have an infection, for example, viral hepatitis. And the platelet count can help us assess if you have thrombocytopenia, which happens when you have low levels of platelets, either because platelet production is slow or because platelet destruction is fast. Thrombocytopenia can be caused by Wilson's disease and by other conditions as well. So now that you know a little bit more about the complete blood count, let's talk about 24-hour urine creatinine. As we covered in Copperheads 8, we measure the 24-hour urine copper concentration because excreting high amounts of copper through the urine strongly suggests a Wilson's disease diagnosis. From the same 24-hour urine sample, the lab will measure the amount of creatinine as well. They do this mostly to check that you did indeed collect your urine for 24 hours, but additionally, high urine creatinine can be a sign of kidney damage, which can be a result of Wilson's disease. There are, of course, other causes of kidney damage, such as diabetes and other conditions, and other causes of high urine creatinine, such as taking certain medications. Let's do a little review, shall we? Today we have talked about the liver function panel, the complete blood count, and the 24-hour urine creatinine test. In my opinion, these tests are just as necessary as the other important tests we covered in previous videos, which are serum coryloplasmin, total serum copper, 24-hour urine copper, and, if possible, free serum copper. If you do not know yet whether you have Wilson's disease or not, and your doctor has not ordered all the tests we have covered today, my advice is that you ask politely, and if necessary, that you insist until they order them. Additionally, depending on your symptoms and your life history, your doctor might want to order additional blood and urine tests. For example, if you have symptoms of liver failure, they might check for infections that cause hepatitis, such as hepatitis A, B, C, D, and E viruses, the yellow fever virus, some herpes viruses, etc. Or if you have symptoms of hypoparathyroidism, they might do some more tests related to that, etc. Alright, Copperheads, we are for now done talking about blood and urine tests. I might return to this in the future after I get through all the main topics I want to cover first. Come back next week to learn about KF rings, sunflower cataracts, and the eye examination that can help diagnose Wilson's disease. Until then, you can subscribe on YouTube, follow on Instagram, like on Facebook, or send me an email. My name is Kupri. See you there, Copperheads!